So welcome to the Business Spotlight Series. My name is Eberhardt Resendiz. People know me as Coach Ever. I am a certified executive and leadership coach at Action Coach in Shreveport, Louisiana. Today I have Greg Redmond, the owner and CEO of Eberhardt Physical Therapy. It's a company located in Shreveport, Louisiana. We are going to be taking a look at the business and the journey on business ownership, the challenges, best practices, and share a peek in what it really is like to build and operate a business, right? If this is your first time on the channel, please be sure to subscribe to get notifications when we drop new conversations just like this one. And so, Greg, thank you for coming. Welcome.
Thank you, Evan.
Please share with us a little overview of your background and tell us a little bit about your business.
Sure. So I'll start personally. I've been in business or doing independent things as a physical therapist since 2007. My wife was actually the more of the entrepreneur than myself. She kind of drew me into the I won't call it a cult, but I would say drew me into the benefits and the understanding of what it was to be more entrepreneurial. I started off my career building a home health consulting business, which I managed originally starting as a physical therapist, running my own consulting and contracting company, working with different home health agencies. In the process of doing that, I started to hire other types of therapists, occupational therapists, speech therapists, and eventually grew a staff of about 30 to 35 therapists working across two states. In that process of learning how to contract and learning how to manage people and learning how to run an organization that was in a growth phase, I made a lot of mistakes. But I think anybody who's been in business, they start by making mistakes and then trying to learn from them and pick up more knowledge as they're going along. And that really does help you cut your way into the business thinking and the individual and people management skills, because you go into it with a set of skills that you bring to that job or that task. But that becomes just another thing you do. That's, you know, hopefully that's the thing you do well, because you have a passion to now share it in a bigger way. But that's kind of where I came from, starting in 2007. Prior to that, I had had jobs in the airline industry and with the U.S. Air Force. So I had some cultured training into doing things on a corporate level and a government level. And I saw those things. I saw the good and I saw the bad. I worked in the VA hospital system as well. So I knew when I started a business, I wanted it to be people focused and not too overly structured. And I knew the inherent flaws in something that was burdened with a lot of steps and things that slowed down the process. And I think when my wife and I, she worked also at the VA system, so she understood the natural tendency for large government systems to move slow on certain things and to be burdened with a lot of rules and things to follow that sometimes made it hard to enjoy everything about your job. So when we went into the entrepreneur side, one of our first keys was, how are we going to enjoy what we do? How are we going to be able to bring our individuality to it in a way that makes us stay excited about doing it all the time? Because we know we're going to be working long hours doing it. And so that was part of what drew me towards the business side of it. I hope that's helped. I'm trying to fill in the gaps when I started off.
It's all part of that discussion. So you acquired this company, right? Eberhardt.
Eberhardt I acquired in 2014. We got a call. Well, I got a call while I was still running the home health business, in the midst of the healthcare changeover that was taking place, where the government was considering getting more into the healthcare business. We were struggling a little bit more in the home health side because there was a lot more contracting going on. And I said, you know, we need to diversify what we do into a brick and mortar type setup. And so I looked for one of the oldest businesses in the area, He had an opportunity for me to come in and work with him for a little bit while he took some time off. And in that process, I had asked him, I said, have you ever considered selling your business? And this is a business that was established in 88. And I knew it had a good book of business. It had a long history of people being very loyal to it. And I thought, you know, if there's going to be a business I want to buy, if I'm going to buy something and not just start it myself, I want to buy it knowing it's got a history of a good book of patients who have trusted it for years. And we'll go back to it because there's some longevity and some reputation to it that I won't bring just walking into it. It's going to have that walking into it when it starts. So yeah, 2014 is when we started the buyout, finished it off in 2018. And
2014 to 2018, that's when you acquired
the business? I would say 2018, 2019. It was right at the end of the year on 2018 to into 2019 when we finalized the buyout. The previous owner separated and went his way. And then we were all, it was all us at that point. So, and when I say us, my wife and I both co-own this business. So she being the dietitian and now the treasurer of the company, she's my other half when it comes to this.
Outstanding. Outstanding. And so set the stage for the viewers, okay, or the listeners. You and your wife are the owners of the business now. There's no other partners in it, right?
That's correct.
What's your role? What's her role, right? And what's the time commitment you guys have at this point?
So I'm the CEO, president of the company. She is the treasurer. As a profession, I am the physical therapist. I've hired others in the past, but we're now back down to just me doing it again. And she is the dietitian or nutritionist. We share duties in the sense of there's certain things that we both handle in the business. She handles a lot more of the kind of social media and pieces that she's gotten good at for other reasons, which she does, which is her other business, which is called Skinny Louisiana. She incorporates what she does as part of her nutrition and dietetics piece on her individual side, but she also brings that to the business as well.
Right.
As we learned more about how to step away from each other, because when it comes to business, if you're too much in each other's business, so to speak, and you don't let somebody be the lead decision maker on things, you learn really hard that you're going to get into decision paralysis, or you're going to fight over something that just needs to be moved forward on. Pardon me.
It's almost like you know, you define, this is where I am good at, this is where you're good at, let's make sure that we can count on each other, but everybody stay on their lane.
Yeah, a lot of that going on early on, especially because we, you know, you have strong personalities. I think in business, as a general rule, you're going to have somebody that's good at making decisions with some forethought, some ability to analyze, and some ability to work cohesively with others, at least in order to form an approach. Because sometimes it's not just about you and it's not just about your opinion. You can get away with that in certain situations, but the bigger encompassing decisions, it's about input. You do have to get input, even if it's not input that you necessarily want or that you think you need. Sometimes that input's valuable because you're not a silo. A lot of these decisions get made and then they affect other people, and they affect either people that you supervise or they pick people that you manage with. And you do have to solicit to get perspective. You know, I draw this to a marriage comparison. You know, when you realize that your wife is a lot more insightful than you gave her credit for, and that she was right so many times, and you look to her when you finally click and you go, man, you know, I really should have started listening to you years and years ago. There were some things that you said to me, and only 3 years later, when they actually came true, did I go, oh man, I really should have listened to my wife. You know, so there's a piece of that I carry into business as well now. And it's, you know, sometimes you don't really see all the obstacles, and when other people are bringing your attention to them, maybe you really ought to give some weight to it, and think about it because these things can come to bear, and it doesn't matter how broad your experience is. Sometimes you're just blind.
Very good. Very good. So let's move on to what makes your business so special. So who primarily your business serve? If I were the audience for your business, right? How will I know it was a good fit for me?
So this is something I had to spend a lot of time thinking about as I was acquiring a business, because I was coming from the type of clientele that had been served here. But of course, I'm different than the previous owner. My wife is different than the previous owner. So we kept asking ourselves, what kind of culture do we want? What kind of people do we want to draw to us by virtue of what do we put out there? And I think what we came down to is this: you know, we are a physical therapy and nutrition and dietitian type practice, but we want it to feel comfortable for when folks walk in to talk to us. They're experiencing a problem. And when you experience a problem, physical and emotional, you know, pain is tied to emotion in a lot of ways.
Yes.
And so we wanted to create a comfortable environment for the older client, for the average working age individual, and folks that were experiencing a decline. When we say decline, it's not always about having a surgery, an ankle surgery or a back surgery or whatever it was. Some of these people are experiencing age-related decline, and they don't know why they're forgetting things. They don't understand why there's certain things that they're taking that people haven't figured out why they're getting a side effect. We want to be the detectives for the sake of their health. And that means we're going to start asking a lot of questions, and we're going to look into their problems in a way that we hope we bring a unique perspective to. Everybody has experience in their line of business. It's how you weigh that experience into the individual case that matters. And whether it's my wife as the dietitian learning about eating disorders and all the complexities of our people's relationship with food.
Right.
In the world of therapy, it's how do I get to the problem as quickly and efficiently as I can, and then bring a light to it based on experience, and bring a light to it based on getting a result that they've struggled to get either on their own or with other providers. And how do I make that meaningful, impactful, and let them feel included and educated in that process? Because I do get feedback from patients that say, you're the first one to have ever really explained what's going on with me, or taken time to educate me, or seem to actually be in this process with me, and not just I got on a tract and I got through the process. And it almost becomes mechanistic when you're in a larger volume situation. That's kind of what I experienced in the government and in other types
right.
of settings. It's too mechanistic and not individualized enough. And when you get into a setting where you're going to be making people uncomfortable, you may be asking them to do things that are challenging, that are outside their comfort zone, or that they bring in preconceived notions of their previous experiences doing things in the physical therapy realm. And how do I dispel those? How do I make them at ease saying, I'm not going to treat you in a way that disrespects your experiences or your concerns? Because a lot of folks come in and they're like, I had a lady in here the other day. I don't know if I want to come in. And I said, well, why? And she's like, I'm afraid that you're going to hurt me. And I'm like, where is that coming from? I had to ask. I was like, well, that's happened the last two times I've done this. And I said, well, how about this? I'll make you a promise. On the first day, we're just going to sit and talk. I said, we're going to come up with a solution you feel comfortable with. And when you finally are at an understanding of my approach, then you can help make the next step. I can tell you what I'd like to work with you on, and then we can be a partner in this process until you feel more at ease. And as we do that, we build a relationship, and not just you're the next piece of the puzzle that I plug into the system. And that relationship building then becomes the nature of how we all build business, right? It's not unique to my field. It's not unique to just about any other field. If you build relationships in business, you gain a longer term client. You show a true care and concern for what desires they bring to you and what you can fulfill. And you see them as somebody who hopefully will be a champion for you later on if you can do well by what they bring as a request. If you do well by them, they give you well beyond what you've given them, which is trust, concern, and a long-term relationship where you feel you can service them over their lifetime.
It's almost like we live in a world where we have a lot of information and noise, but nobody really is listening. So it is refreshing when you find people who actually take the time to listen to what's happening to them and be able to take it in so they can offer something. That's remarkable, very remarkable, Greg. So what's one thing you wish more people knew about your business?
I think the depth of how we care. You know, right now I have we have a great staff, a lean staff, but every person in our organization really cares about the experience that a client gets when they walk in our door. We call them if they're not showing up. We ask them if they're okay. If they go into the hospital or if they have a doctor's appointment, we offer to help in whatever way we can. If they've had something happen to them, let's say they fell at home or whatever, we're on the phone with them. We're saying, are you okay? Have you been all right? What's going on over the next few days? We invest time into that relationship that goes beyond you walking in the door and walking out the door. We really do want to know how we can best be present for you. I've got a husband and wife that have been coming here on and off through multiple hospitalizations, and she'll call me and she'll ask for my advice and she'll ask for questions that she can ask her physician or ask whoever it is she's seeing, because she knows she'll get the time from me. She knows that if I have experience or I have knowledge that will benefit them, or even just a perspective as a somebody that's not a lay person handling the things in the medical system, I'll give her a perspective, an opportunity to ask educated questions that help her bring value to the other relationships she has in her medical provider relationships. It exceeds my charge that I get when they walk in here. But I figured if I've got anything to bring to bear to help them stay healthier, get a better experience in the medical system, I'll help go to bat with them to help them find information.
Love it. Love it. Let me ask you these. This is perhaps an off question. You then have to balance your capacity with this amount of handholding or care, right?
Mm-hmm.
How do you do that?
There's an amount of tough love that goes into all of this. It's not unlike handling kids. You know, there's an amount of respect that you get by virtue of your position when you're caring for somebody. And that can go easily go over the boundaries if you allow them to step too hard on your time or your desire to be able to reassure them. You always have to help clearly define a boundary when they step on it. And, you know, I've got people in here that say, hey, you know, they decided to just walk in the middle of a busy day in clinic. And I said, one, you have the ability, all of our systems right now, which we've converted to, allow them to text us at any hour of the day. They can text our main phone number at any hour of the day. And if I have the ability to respond and I have the time, I will do it. There's all different ways of getting a hold of us. If I can't, and I get somebody that says, hey, you know, you didn't respond to me, I was like, I have times where my family comes first, and that's the time that I get. I will do everything I can to help service you, but the boundaries are very important in business and in life.
That's
And
right.
as long as they understand that, I think that's healthy. That's a healthy place to put yourself, because you can prioritize without disrespecting. And I think they feel that value when you bring it. Just like kids respond to good structure and good boundaries that you create for them. It's true in all relationships. Good boundaries are a healthy place to begin and a healthy place to maintain.
Excellent. Wow. Okay, there's plenty there to chew on, but let me ask you this. We our businesses, we leave on our ability to reach people and work with them, right? Whatever product or service we're offering to them. And so that leads me to the question of marketing. I'm always curious about what businesses are doing. What percentage of your sales or your revenue is invested back into marketing? What strategies do we follow to reach out and let the people know that you're there and you're offering this extremely valuable service that you provide?
This is probably a weak area for me, and that's self-admitted. I have worked harder over the last, let's say, 4 years, maybe over since COVID really kind of hit the US, a lot on just building relationships with my client base. And I've noticed that more of the referrals now that I get are based on patients talking to other potential people who become clients, and providers contacting us saying, how do we get people into you, even though I've not necessarily solicited to those medical providers recently. A lot of times it's just a, hey, thanks for your business. Here's just one of our script pads. We do appreciate it. These are the new things that we've been doing. We've implemented some additional programming, and I've sent out letters to several providers that we've had previous good referral-based relationships with. I have avoided very strictly providing any kind of meals, lunch, incentives, any of that stuff to medical providers. And that's intentional. I'm not here to kiss butt. I'm not here to try to do so in such a way that I felt like I had to buy your relationship, because if I did, it's really not real and it's not going to last. I mean, to be frank, none of the relationships I've ever tried to build based on sitting down and having a lunch or whatever
Quid
have
pro
really
quo.
turned. Yeah, the quid pro quo is really an allusion to a relationship. It's not a real relationship. A real relationship is when you do share a communication line. You do share a set of values around how you choose to do things or how you choose to communicate with respect. And I felt that much more valuable in the client base than I have within the provider community. Because the provider community, to be honest, is very oversolicited, and it's easy to get lost in the cloud of marketing mechanisms that have pre-existed us ever doing what I'm doing.
Right.
I don't see a point in fighting that game. I really, to me, if I can reach an individual and care for them, and offer to care for any of their friends, and if I'm a resource to them in any way where they can say, hey, just call them, they'll be happy to help you. To be honest, that's how it's really helped, is just being real, being genuine, being available when possible, providing time. If somebody says, hey, can you take a few minutes to speak with me? Of course. If somebody said, can you get somebody, and part of the other part of that, which I really didn't hit on, this happened to me the other day. I can't say who, but I cared for a few athletes, and the athletes were just sent in. The guy asked me to help them. I got them in within a day, and I started working with them. They did great. 3, 4 weeks, they were back and doing whatever they needed to do, no problem. And it all came to par very quick. Suddenly I get a call, and I get a call from somebody, and he goes, hey, this is my name, and I recognize the name. Well, I thought I did. It was the father of the person who sent him to me. And I said, well, how'd you hear about us? And he said, well, my son mentioned that you had worked with some folks that he had sent over. And he said you got in very quick, and he took great care of him, and it was all that, just that relationship thing. And I said, well, when can you be here? And he's like, you mean today? I said, I have time this afternoon. Come on in. It's about proximity of the request to when you can service. If I said I can't get in for 2 weeks, well, it could work one of two ways. Well, at least in my head, one of two ways. Wow, this must be a valuable service, right? I have to wait 2 weeks. Or if we can get him in right away. Wow, that fast? I'm not used to that in the healthcare system, right? You know, are you that desperate or are you that good? And now I have to prove to him, am I that good? Right? And I'm okay with that.
Yeah.
I'm okay with the idea that I'm that good. Because if I am, boy, that's a real win right there. That I'm good, I care, I got them in, I made them feel better. Hopefully I addressed their problem effectively, and I got them ready to go do whatever they wanted to do, and I got them a chance to really experience what I was hoping they would, which is expediency of service, genuine care for them, and hopefully the result they were looking for.
You know what I'm sensing here, Greg, is that it's a lot about having the right heart for it.
Yeah,
it's like, you know, you love on your clients, the fact that you put so much effort into caring for them is not just from the mouth out. It really comes from the heart. I can tell. And that's bound to attract the right kind of people towards you. Okay. So
I'm gonna say one other thing. I make a request when I pray at night, and that is for God to bring people to us. And I just let that be whatever God wills. And that's my one Christian bit in the midst of this is, I know I'm not in control of everything. I know there is the potential for me to care for many people. It's only through God that that's possible. And I just ask for that to be the will of God and whatever it might bring. And that's, I truly believe that is part of the blessing that has allowed me to be molded by his will. So that's
very good.
Just that little bit.
Very good. I appreciate that. So we spent a lot of time focused on the business and sharing, you know, some of the things that you do. As you look back at the journey that you've had since you started doing these, what's the most memorable roadblock that comes to mind for you? Hurdle or challenge that you had to overcome? You were forced to overcome.
Forced to overcome. Okay, I like that. I don't know how salty do you want me to be?
It's look, everybody in business has gone through these, right?
Okay,
for
good.
Some of us, it's been big failures. For some of us, have been a consistent amount of small failures, but they all in aggregate really affect us, right?
Business teaches you hardness and how to move on from it. So I would say, there's two that have come to mind. I'm going to give you the first one, and then I'll give you the second one just as a byproduct. One is having to forcibly separate the previous owner from the business, just by virtue of things not going to plan the way we had anticipated. It wasn't the way I would like to have things to have had to have happened. I would have hoped the contract would have gone naturally to its natural endpoint. And that was hard. That was hard because when you do something and you start with a perspective of this is how we're going to start, this is how we're going to end, this is our my hopes that this is the way it'll be smoothly done and that will be amicable and be able to rely upon, you know, our initial contract for sale and things like that. And it just didn't go that way. And it went harder and much more emotional and financially bound. It stunk. I mean, it was hard because we had to figure out how to reorient ourselves after all that emotional tumult, and it affected our ability to, it stalled everything, you know, and that's right. Hard when everything kind of stalls because you quite, you know, it didn't work the way you thought it was going to work. And now we have to figure out how to rebuild our image in our own head about what we were doing. I think there was
these like
there
trying
was
to create your culture and finding that as an obstacle.
Yeah, I think that was a part of it, is we hadn't really invested in creating the culture quite the way we should have. And maybe because you have legacy and then you have new and you don't know how to bridge the gap between the way things were and the way things should be for yourself and your new organization, it's a tough place to be because you don't really know how to. I think I have a good sense of it now, but it took a while in order for me to build that sense.
Very good.
Yeah.
Very good.
And then I would say, you know, anything beyond that was usually a bigger financial mistake, something where you encountered a major financial burden, right? Something you didn't realize you were paying for, or something you have to pay for. Big financial burdens to a business, if they're traumatic, make you scared.
They stay with you.
Yeah. And so, you know, that was probably a secondary one, but I think the first one was the one I talked about.
Okay. So as we're coming to the close, I mean, we covered a lot of these, right? And there's so many questions that we could talk for hours, right?
Mm-hmm, sure.
We're going to go into a rapid fire session now. Just cover some of the things. Don't think through them too much. You know, almost a couple of head answers for each one of these, okay?
So
we're gonna go through these. It's a long answer, very quick. What is the key to success for you?
Adaptability. I think if you can adapt to new situations, you'll feel empowered by your ability to be creative and stay in your business. Like, feel it, react, and go.
Right. Very good. What is one piece of advice that you will have for other business owners?
What was it? Don't lose your passion. Don't lose your passion for what you do. And that whether it's running the business itself or the specific occupation you're in or how you put the two of them together, don't lose it. It will show in your business. And if it shows in your business and you're not invested in it, it's not going to go well for very long.
Right. What's one book you're reading now or have read recently?
Oh, crap. Oh,
you're not reading?
It's on my shelf, I think. Oh, man, I had it. It was a business management book my sister gave to me. I'll try to make it quick. It was a story about an executive who had to leave a company. You probably know the book. Had to leave a company, and the company sold out. He ended up having to retire. You know, let's say he wasn't really ready to retire, but he had to retire. His wife and him moved to some place. I can't remember what exactly it was. And he ended up running a pizza restaurant or co-managing a pizza restaurant.
And I think only three signs of a miserable job.
That's it. And it was quite a book to read for the sake of understanding the employee's perspective and understanding the management perspective and how important it is to see the barriers present in your own thinking and the barriers in the employee's thinking and how to find ways for each to appreciate one another. And also to see the importance of how that relationship is the driver of real employee success and management success for that matter and management satisfaction.
Fair enough. Very good.
Yeah.
So if you had to choose one area for your business you could immediately improve tomorrow, what will it be?
Immediately improve tomorrow.
It will make a big difference for you if you get this fixed right away.
I would say tie up your loose ends on the accounting and financial side. Know your, you know, if you can work with a great accountant and a great administrative person to work together to see your business, there's always holes and leaks and gaps and things in there that you're not seeing because your business, you know, there's business law changes, there's rule changes, there's tax changes, all these things change all that's every year. And you're going to be blind to them as a business owner if you're in the minutia of everything else you're doing. So I think that's a great piece to recapture some revenue, to gain some tax advantage, and to know where you could be losing things that you don't need to lose.
Right. There's a lot of ways going on in the business world because we just don't pay enough attention.
No, I mean, you're never, there's always holes in the boat. You know, you can only stick your fingers in so many holes, you know, and it's still leaking.
That's a great reference. The problem is that, you know, we're never, we're not in a dinghy boat. We're
no,
in a yacht.
It's a cruise liner.
All right. So before we get to the final question of the day, yeah. How can others learn more about you or your company? How can they get in touch with you?
Sure. So at any time, we try to have an open door policy. We have parties around here all the time. So, you know, if you walk in and we're doing Cinco de Mayo with the traditional Mexican bingo on May 3rd, which you might understand that because the cards are really cute. But you can go to our website at www.eberhardtpt@gmail.com, or you can email us at the same thing, Gmail. You can text us. Our main phone number is 318-222-7442, and we have the ability to, you'll get an automatic reply back from us if we don't answer, even if it's after hours. We'd be happy to share anything we're doing with our clients and client base, whether it's nutrition, dietetics, wellness, whatever it is.
Any social media handles?
Social media on Facebook at 820PT, @820PT on Facebook.
All right. So as we come to the end, the last question is, what's most inspiring for you today?
Wow. Actually, reflecting on a lot of this, because I don't do as much reflection as I do, you know, my day to day. But I would say the most inspiring thing now is the opportunity to serve others and to gain from them their, you know, I get life experience passed at me every day. You know, I've got retired Air Force colonel giving me advice one day. I've got a old Navy salty guy giving me advice the next day. I've got a retired, you know, teacher of three children that gives me advice another day. I gained so much in this process that I could never predict. And that's inspiring because I know they're here and they're sharing their lives with us. You know, it's building a new family. It's building another family that we get to enjoy. And if they keep coming back, it's just like, you know, we get visits every week. So it's great.
We say in my world, as business coaches, that, you know, you got to continue acquiring new customers all the time, but it's really the ones that return that make a difference.
Yeah, absolutely.
Right. All right. Excellent, Greg. Thank you so much for these. Thank you. This is great. And again, I'll make sure that we pass this on to everybody. Okay.
Thank you, Ever.